Stand, salute the flag, please. Let the allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Minutes of the meeting held 194-95. That's the first meeting held on June 13th, 1994. Does anybody have any comments, corrections?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Linnell?
On item number 12, there is one correction I'd like to make. Voting no on that was myself. I voted no on number 12. Inadvertently, you and I sharing the same first name, it was recorded as Bill Jordan voting no, but it was I who voted no on number 12.
So what is your wishes?
I'd like to move that we accept the minutes of the last meeting with the
as correct?
As corrected.
A second.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody got any comment? All those in favor, raise your hand. Thank you. Next item is citizen discussion of items not on the agenda. Anybody out there have anything they'd like discussing not on the agenda? Hearing none, move on to the next item. Reports and correspondence. Anybody got any reports and correspondence they would like? Councilor Linnell.
Mr. Chairman, I'd just like to report that I've been selected to serve on the Alternative Modes Committee of the Portland Area Comprehensive Transportation Committee. This is something that will study more efficient, more environmentally friendly means of transportation, and it may include some bike path establishment and hopefully some funding of bike paths. And so I'm very pleased to be on that committee.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Councilor McGough.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We received a memorandum at our last meeting, but we did not publicize it, and I think it's worthy of making note, that at its annual meeting on June 10th, the Maine Association of Planners presented an honorable mention award to the town for its town center planning project. And I think it's especially noteworthy because this was the one planning project that was written by in-house staff rather than by consultants, and I commend our planner, Maureen O'Meara, for the work. Thank you.
Anybody else?
Just a,
go ahead.
If I might, Mr. Chairman, just a quick mention that the town library lost one of its very valuable employees with the retirement 2 weeks ago of Norma Wadman. Norma had worked at the library full-time since 1980 and a couple of part-time years. In addition to that, she was known to many as one of the smiling faces at the front desk and was certainly extremely dedicated and talented, and she will be missed. So I want to thank Norma for all of her work for the community and for the library.
Thank you. Anybody else? Moving along, we'll have open the public hearing for the school parking. School traffic regulations. Everybody got a. This been. You want to touch base a little bit on that, sir?
Yes, I'd be happy to. What this proposal does is eliminate a lot of antiquated provisions within the code of ordinances relating particularly to the middle school mall, which effective today no longer exist as a thoroughfare. What it does do is otherwise clarify the traffic as it now exists in the parking on the school grounds and also provide some flexibility during any school construction projects for temporary signage. One provision that is apt to be controversial is that it provides that there's no parking at any time on any area that is grassed, including ball fields, esplanades, and lawns. We have had a growing problem in recent years with folks parking on the lawns and on the athletic fields, and anyone that would speak to you about school safety would indicate that where kids are playing in and around fields, it's not the best place for folks to be parking. This was referred to the school board. To my knowledge, there weren't any comments that did come back, but they did have a chance to review it. It was also reviewed by the public safety chiefs and the director of public works.
Anybody from the public would care to make a comment? Hearing none, I believe we'll close the public hearing and move on to item 21, to consider proposed amendments to the traffic regulations regarding parking traffic on school grounds and taking necessary action. What is your wishes?
Mr. Chairman, I would move the proposed amendments.
Second it.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody getting a comment? Yes, Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Having just heard the manager say that the intent is clarity, I need some help in clarifying a few things. In section 1372, one-way traffic, the language that we are repealing and replacing, which is the current language, says these provisions shall not apply to town snow plowing vehicles during snow plowing operations, nor to mowers during mower operations. Do we need to specify that, or do we have that generically included somewhere else in this ordinance?
I don't know.
And neither did the police chief.
No, I don't believe it is generically included elsewhere in the ordinance.
If it's not included generically elsewhere, based on my conversation today with the police chief, I would like to have that sentence retained and not stricken. I'm going to keep going. Getting down to the parking restrictions that the manager explained in the school complex, the language talks about within the Pond Cove school complex. I'm wondering if we are limiting these restrictions to the Pond Cove part of the school campus, and if so, where the line is, and why aren't we restricting it throughout the school campus?
If you look up above, within the Pond Cove school complex, being bounded by Ocean House Road, Scott Dye Road, Elizabeth Park, and the Spurwink Marsh, it clearly takes in everything.
Okay, I missed that. Thank you. I then have a problem that we're only doing this. So tell me, what does that mean? We should just, is that the entire? No, not the entire.
It's the entire Pond Cove school complex. This covers the entire complex.
Including the high school grounds?
Everything.
And why do we call it the Pond Cove School Complex?
Because this area of town is referred to as Pond Cove. It has nothing to do with Pond Cove Elementary School. It's the area of
it's
town.
It's very confused wording then. Maybe it's just me. I don't know. I think we could just say school complex rather than the Pond Cove School Complex, since we no longer have two school complexes. I imagine that may be where it started from when we had the school at the northern end of town. So I would suggest that we say within the school complex to include, make it clear to everybody who has to deal with this that we're talking about the entire school grounds. And then I do have problems, and I think I mentioned these in May. There's still a concern that we're saying there's no parking at any time in some of these areas. I understand from my conversation with the police chief that we, and I totally agree that we do not want to saturate the school complex with signs. But for the number of years I've driven, I tend to assume I can park somewhere unless it's really obvious that you shouldn't or there's a no parking sign. And I think there are some places here we're going to somehow want to indicate there is no parking rather than assuming people go up there and understand that it's no parking rather than parking is permitted. I really have a problem with it. I don't know if we achieve this by painting signs, lettering it on the road, or we have one sign at each entrance saying no, just basically no parking, and outline it, or how we deal with it. But I really think it's going to be confusing, and I think we're going to have some problems. Another concern I have is with the enforcement we're going to have. I think we send very conflicting messages when we enforce it sometimes, but not all the time. We're dealing with a lot of high school drivers. The last thing we need to do is send mixed messages to that age group, let alone to the adults.
Yes, go ahead.
If I could respond to a couple of your points. As for the placement of signs, you know, this whole thing is structured to allow us to place the do's and the do not signs where appropriate. You know, in the past, whenever, you know, with the one exception of an item later this evening, when the council has passed these ordinances, they generally haven't told us to put a sign every 10 feet or whatever. You know, I have confidence that, as we've done in the past, that the Public Works Director, Police Chief, and I, we routinely have meetings to say this is where the signs go. In fact, when the middle school mall was abandoned last week, we took all the signs and saved them so that to make sure we have plenty of signs to put back up. So, you know, I'm not sure what you're reading here that indicates we won't have signs directing people where to park and where not to park. For example, Fort Williams, we generally don't have signs every 10 feet saying no parking on the road. It says park only in designated areas. Once in a while, we find we do have to put up additional signs, and we do when other parking gets out of hand. But that ordinance is written so that parking is only allowed in certain areas and has the assumption that parking is not allowed in other areas. As for enforcement, you know, one of the problems we've had, and it addresses a later item on the agenda, is we wish to enforce these rules at all times, and we wish to have the facilities in place that enables us to enforce them, that enables cars to be parked where they're supposed to be parked. You know, one of the problems we've had in the past is we don't have enough parking spaces. It's not organized. One of the good things about this whole school project is we have plenty of new additional parking so that we can enforce. And, you know, if there's any things we get complaints about, it's over-enforcement of this ordinance. I think that the police get more complaints about that than any other issue in town, even more than barking dogs at this point. So I wish to reassure you that we will enforce it adequately. Whether or not you wish to rename the school complex, that's up to the council.
Councilor Nell.
It seems to me that in reading the language that there is a lot of flexibility in leaving it to the police chief and whatnot as to just exactly where they put the signs, parking signs, and they can move them if they want. I guess as far as tonight, I'm sort of reluctant to change the name of something. I mean, that Pond Cove school may appear in contracts or something, and I'd be reluctant to change that tonight, and maybe perhaps that could be done sometime later. I'd rather not do that without talking to the school board and making sure there isn't some, you'd have to change every contract that's been written, something like that. I think the Councilor McLaughlin's point on including the snow plowing is on target. I was looking in the ordinance, and something from the 60s just said snow plowing. The most recent one added mowing operations, lawn mowing, so it looks like there was some intent to address that. And so I would suggest that we accept these school parking regulations, perhaps with an amendment just to include an exception for town snow plowing and mowing operations in the interest of moving this along.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Councilor.
Are we going to vote on the agenda?
What? Been moved and second? Therefore, you have discussion?
Sorry.
Go ahead.
I would like to ask that we, and perhaps the school board is already doing this, are make some plan to inform the parents about where the parking is going to be and where it isn't going to be, and update them on a regular basis. I know that it's been an ongoing problem among the Pond Cove parents that they go to volunteer and there's no place to park, so you park kind of over on one edge because it doesn't really say not to, and then you come out and you have a ticket. And I know, especially on like field day and those kind of events where there's a lot of parents that come all at once, it really leaves a bitter taste in a lot of people's mouths. And I think they know that they need to allow for emergency vehicles to come through, and that's the intent of the ordinance, but I also think that they need to be reminded on a regular basis. And this is a little bit confusing, so maybe something that, maybe drew a little map for them and told them exactly where they're allowed to park and update it on a regular basis would alleviate that situation.
Gil, anybody else? Yes, Councilor Clausen.
I concur with Councilor McLaughlin as far as the reference of the school complex. I think it's not as general as we want it to be to say Pond Cove, and I do think, and Councilor Marvin just referenced Pond Cove, the Pond Cove School, so I think it would be better to have it just say the school complex. So therefore, I guess, do we put, amend your motion to change the name to school complex?
Second.
Under 1373.
Councilor Dalbert.
As the maker of the motion, I will accept the change to eliminate the words Pond Cove.
Okay. Anybody else?
I was going to ask this, would Councilor Dalbeck make any comment on the snow plowing mowing operation? Would you like to amend that also?
No, I would strictly stick to the change of the name of the complex to eliminate confusion. Other than that, I'll leave it up to the town departments to take care of the rest.
Not to belabor this point, but would it make sense to say Pond Cove Middle and High School complexes? Would that make
just sense? Says school complex, I think that's pretty obvious.
Councilor McGough.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A question of the manager. When would this, if this ordinance is adopted this evening, when would it become effective?
30 days.
I'm trying to think what usage there will be in those sports fields. It will be, I guess, it will be the week before preseason for the high school students. So there needs to be some way of making sure that they and their parents also are aware of the new restrictions, because those people do park in the grass areas now.
The reality is those areas are going to be inaccessible for vehicles for the next 2 years, because the site is closed off as a construction site. So there is no way to gain access to those areas where folks have traditionally, in recent years, I shouldn't say traditionally, where folks in recent years have parked.
The back soccer field?
There's going to be no way to get down there.
Don't say
that. Oh, you're talking about the one down by the high school?
Yeah.
Oh, that one, yeah.
Yeah. So, I mean, these restrictions are going to be, my understanding is these restrictions will be enforced. And
there'll be signs.
And there will be signs and such, and we have to make sure that the high school users and their audience are aware of that. And I'll be careful.
Councilor Cogshaw.
Although she probably hadn't planned on making a statement in reference to notification of parents with the chairman of the school board, care to comment on that suggestion? Knowing Ann, I'm sure you already have a plan in mind.
Well, all I would say is that there is a transition committee that is working on all those kinds of things, and Sue Weatherby is actually now in charge system-wide of communications of all sorts, about blasting, about parking, about, you know, any changes. So I'm sure this will be included in her communications, and knowing Sue, they'll be excellent. But I will make sure I pass it on to her how important it is to you and to the high school parents and stuff.
Thank you. Anybody else? I just got one comment as far as the whole thing goes. During the construction, and there's going to be parking problems around, I can see why while they're building the road to get around to the what I call the back of the school, which is going to be the front of the school. And if there's any activity on the athletic field there, people are going to be ticketed because they pull out of the way onto the grass there to watch. And if some kind of an event for the youngsters and whatever you. I think this is a little premature myself, and it should be something to be done when you get all the construction work done, especially the land, whatever you. Then they'll really know where they can come out and through the parking and whatever.
To answer your question, sir, these ordinance amendments are specifically drafted to allow flexibility during construction and to allow the public safety chiefs to allow temporary parking in different areas during the construction period. Right now, for instance, there's no parking along Scott Dyer Road. The zoning board put that as a condition of the approval of the school project. This ordinance at least gives temporary authority for people to park there during the construction. Secondly, I have a tough time believing it'll be ready by September 1, but the new very large parking lot behind, in front of whatever, the new school area renovation, connector, whatever it's called, you have to be careful with names tonight, will be ready around the time school starts. So that should alleviate a lot of the prior problem with folks having nowhere to park.
Supposedly,
yes. Yeah. It'll be tight.
Anybody else? Are you all set? So I believe the proper procedure is to vote on the amendment.
With the elimination of the word Pond Cove.
Right. Did everybody understand it? They want it read back?
I'd like it read back, please.
Yes. You have it?
My understanding of the amendment would be to retain the language that snowplows and mowers would be excluded in that portion, because the amendment to the second degree count that was moved by Councilor Cogswell and seconded by Councilor McLaughlin, Councilor Dahlbeck then stated that he would add in his original motion that it would just state school complex. So that would eliminate that amendment to the second degree. So I'm assuming that unless the seconder, which is Councilor Chappell, unless he has an objection, that the amendment would be only the plow and mowing sentence. And if that passes, it goes back to the original motion, which would include school complex terminology, with, if the amendment passes, that would include the amendment as well. So I guess my question is, does Councilor Chappell agree?
Yes. What happens if I say yes?
Then we're all set. We can proceed.
The worst question is, what happens if you say no?
Let's try a vote. I'll go along.
Okay. So the amendment that you're voting on is the language that would exclude the snow plows and the mowers. That language.
That language would continue in the ordinance.
That's correct.
That would continue in the ordinance.
That's the only thing you'd be voting on right now. That's the amendment.
Includes it.
Everybody understand it?
No.
That's your amendment.
That's your amendment.
I thought it's included?
Yeah. Yes.
We're voting whether...
You would like that statement to remain in the parking regulations.
Okay.
I think so.
Everybody understand it?
Sure. I believe so.
We understand. Now tell us what happens if we vote yes.
You can read it in the minutes next month.
You'll be able to have the lawn mowed without trespassing.
Right.
And the snow plow, if it gets a wing on the grass, will not be fine.
Right.
All those in favor of the amendment, please indicate by raising your right hand. Now, I believe that we have got to eliminate.
Do we have any opposed?
Oh, excuse me. I thought everybody raised their hand. Who's opposed? I'm sorry.
There may be an abstention.
He had his hand up down there.
I had it. Yeah.
Oh, did you?
Everybody had their hand up.
What happened to my vote? Yes, you told me it was all right.
Oh, okay. Did you raise your little finger?
Okay.
Did you get it?
Okay.
All set?
All set.
Okay, now to eliminate the words Pond Cove.
I believe that's part of the motion.
That was part of the motion.
Part of the original motion.
That isn't the way you had it.
Right.
No, what you'll be voting on now is the original motion, which would include the words "school complex only." The original motion you're voting on now, as amended, which would include that statement that talks about the snowplows and the mowers.
Okay.
Try this again.
Everybody understand it?
No.
No?
You're voting on the original motion as amended. The amendment is to retain the language that talks about the snowplows and the mowers. Which you just voted on.
That's right.
Your original motion, Counselor Dahlbeck, now includes the wording "school complex only."
Correct. That's what we voted on, right?
No.
That's what we're voting on.
That's what you're voting on now, because that became part of your original motion.
All set?
I am waiting for the minutes next month.
All those in favor, raise your hand.
Whatever.
Those opposed? 6-0, 7-0. Okay, moving right along.
Dennis is there on the right.
That was an easy one, too.
I'm like Counselor Dahlbeck, I'm going to wait and read the minutes. To consider, item 22, consider receiving the report of the Land Use Process Review Committee and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager, do we have...
Yes.
I believe we have a gentleman here, Mr. Warren.
Mr. Henry Warren, the chairman of the committee.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and members of the council. Mike got back from overseas just in time to stop me from reading all 38 recommendations of his committee. And I was reluctant until he told me I didn't have to wear a tie. That sold me, so... I'm very pleased to present this report to the council tonight. The committee, as you know, was appointed late last year to bring together members of the primary land use regulatory bodies in town to talk about process, not about substance, because of complaints and concerns about the way that land use ordinances in Cape Elizabeth are administered, or at least have been sometimes perceived to be administered. And the report which you have is based on a number of committee meetings and a survey that we did of everyone who had participated as a client, if you will, or who had been touched by the system for the two previous years. And also we invited the public to participate through the Cape Courier and through questionnaires available here at Town Hall. We started off by defining the problem as we understood it, and that's on page one of your report, and then spent quite a bit of time talking about customers and what customer service means. That's on page two. And then perhaps the most helpful thing that we did, especially for someone like myself who has no familiarity with Cape Elizabeth's ordinances, is to develop for each of the major ordinances a flowchart which carries the interested person, whether an applicant or a citizen or a member of a board, through the process in a fairly straightforward manner. We did that in part for ourselves, but ultimately with the idea in mind that it would become a part of the materials available to anyone touched by the process and hopefully make it easier for them. Those charts are available starting on page 13. There are 38 recommendations, as I indicated, and I will not mention them, but what I would like to mention briefly is a couple of the focuses which I drew from the process that the committee went through and the recommendations that came from the process. One is that there needs to be more of an emphasis on better communications between the land use boards and committees. There are some clear recognition, and in fact, in many cases, I think desire on the part of the people represented around that table to talk more to each other, to find ways, both formal and informal, to share information and make sure that they aren't tripping over each other or creating problems for each other or for the customers, the applicants, and the citizens that are affected by the process. There's also a strong need for earlier intervention with applicants in the development review process. The flowcharts that I mentioned are part of that. but there are a number of other recommendations which lean in that direction and would be helpful. And in some cases, there are recommendations for major restructuring of some of the regulations. One of the recommendations which we would also like to make specifically to this body is a reinstitution of a historic process which sort of dribbled away apparently over the last 2 or 3 years, where the town council chair and others who may be interested met on a periodic basis 2 or 3 times a year with the chairpersons of each of the 3 land use committees, the planning board, the zoning board, and the conservation commission, just to touch base, to share problems, to talk about needs for the future, and to make suggestions for any ordinance changes that might seem worth looking into. We recommend strongly that you reinstitute that process, and since Councilor Jordan, now Chairman Jordan, sat on the committee, he heard that firsthand and certainly, I think, agreed with it, so hopefully that will be picked up. That is the essence of the recommendations. I won't go into any of the other details. I'd be more than glad to try to answer any questions. Let me just finish by saying, as I did in my cover letter to the chair, that the degree of cooperation and knowledge which existed on that committee surprised me. I frankly thought I would be dealing with people who were in disagreement, a substantial disagreement with each other, and that was the cause of creating this committee. If that was the cause, that disagreement did not show up at the committee meetings. They were way out of their way to try to be helpful, to make suggestions, to help each other and their various committees, and the result was an easy process. And at the risk of swelling Maureen McGovern's head, I'll pile on to Councilor McLaughlin's earlier comment and say that, at least in this experience that I had with her, she was extremely knowledgeable and, most important, retains after all this time a good humor about the whole process, which is sometimes not easy to do. So with that, I'll entertain any questions you may have.
Thank you. Anybody got any comments, questions? Yes, Councilor Cogshill.
I served on this committee, and I must say it was indeed a great pleasure to be on a committee that had outstanding chairmanship. This was a very complicated process, and we could have been floundering for a long time, but we had clear direction, and I'm amazed we finished ahead of time. I want everyone to know we didn't ask for an extension. We finished ahead of time. Mr. Henry's
thank you.
Work.
Anybody else? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hank, during the committee's conversations, was it ever discussed the possibility of having staff determine completeness of applications?
It was, and I, ironically, and to my surprise, since I, as a bureaucrat for many years, have always grabbed for the maximum amount of power I could get, the planner McGovern indicated a strong desire not to be in a position where that was authority that she had. She felt, and the planning board members seemed to agree, that that the process is not substantially delayed by completeness being determined at the planning board level, and that because completeness sometimes is very important to the way that an applicant perceives the process, that she would prefer not to be in the threshold seat, if you will, where that decision is made. And the committee discussed it at some length and eventually agreed with her. I believe, however, there are several recommendations designed to try to speed up the process, particularly at the planning board level, so that, as we said in my comments earlier, early intervention is the sought after goal. And one of those early interventions involves getting the applicant and anybody else that's interested to a workshop session of the planning board as early as possible in the process, so the completeness issues and other things can be discussed before any final decisions are made.
Yeah, I would respectfully disagree with that conclusion about having staff determine completeness. I think it does add at least a month to the process, and I know other communities where staff very successfully takes on that responsibility, not because they are looking for the responsibility, but because it expedites the process and it works effectively for everybody. I'm disappointed that it's not in here.
Well, I understand your concern, and as I said, we did discuss it at some length. There is, as you know, probably a fairly detailed checklist which the planner maintains for completeness as material is submitted both by applicants and other parties, including town staff. And in a sense, de facto, that checklist determines completeness, but the ultimate legal decision is left to the planning board.
Yes?
Yeah, I'd just like to comment. I really appreciate the effort that went into this. I think it's an excellent report. What I'd like to suggest, perhaps at some point, if Maureen O'Meara, Chairman Warren, and Phyllis Cogdill, I'm having trouble pronunciation this evening, who's going to be chairing the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, the ZORC Committee, that perhaps we get together sometime and specifically go through all of the recommendations and with an eye toward, one, accomplishing those that are immediately achievable, and two, deciding those which are best handled by the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee, but really try to get this thing moving, and then, as I suggest in the agenda notes, perhaps make a progress report to the town council in October. The other thing is I would like to echo what Hank has said about the work that Maureen O'Meara has done on this project. It was not easy to do. Her position is not easy, and particularly with some of the comments that came out through the process, but I think the way she handled it was extremely professional, and it really gives all of us an opportunity to positively look forward at how we can best not only do the planning process, but the zoning process and the entire land use process. So I'd like to express my personal appreciation to Henry and to Maureen and to the rest of the committee.
Thank you.
Let me, if I could just add, first of all, I would certainly be more than willing, and I'm sure anybody else on the committee wouldn't be, to sit with you or anybody else and try to work through this. In fact, the first recommendation is the hope that the next committee, Councillor Cogdill's committee, will meet with our committee at their first meeting just to go through the issues. The only other concern I have is that a meeting of ZORC and LERP sounds like something out of Star Wars and is a little scary, so.
Okay. Councillor Nell.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I went through this this document, this report of the land use regulation process, and having recently, very recently, gone through this as an applicant, I wanted to say that I think this document does point out a lot of areas which could be improved, like anything. And I know that there are times when the town planner was on the hot seat and sometimes the messenger of some of these regulations, which sometimes overlap and so forth. And I know that there are times when I didn't agree with everything, but I would like to thank the everyone that worked on this, and certainly Maureen O'Meara for her efforts, and I found her very professional and knowledgeable also.
Did you send your survey in?
No, I didn't. I thought at the time it would be best to wait, not to do it under the heat of the moment.
I just want to, anybody else? I just want to say I think Councillor Cogdill put it very well, and I agree with 100% of the work that you've done, Hank, as far as steering this committee through a tough process. And there's one thing I would like to add is what Councillor McLaughlin brought up about staff. I think that in listening to her at some of the meetings there, that she figures that she's gone far enough as far as telling them, yes, you can go, or no, you can't, because you're not ready to go. And this is to the planning board. And she pointed that out, I think, a couple of times when the authority went. And I think she felt that we agreed that she should be able to tell them, yes, you are ready to go before the board or not. So, but I don't know how far, as far as planning goes, you take other places where they have a staff. I think they could go beyond that, but that is the reason we didn't really make any big changes, I thought. Now I could be off base a little. Okay?
Thank you.
Yes, Councilor Marvin.
Is this going to workshop now? Are we going to review these, or if there's something that I want to discuss, I should bring it up now, or now's the time?
Now's the time.
Okay. On page 4, item number 6, it has to do with the associate board members. We had talked at length about this in one of our workshops, and it's something that I feel a little bit uncomfortable with, what the report contains regarding that. The school board and the town council don't have associate members, and I find it hard to understand why the planning board would have an associate member, particularly when, as it states right here, associate members often are appointed to vote on applications in the place of full members. So it doesn't make any sense to me why you vote some issues and you don't vote other issues. Why wouldn't you just make them a full member? And obviously there's going to be some conflicts of interest, so people have to step down, and that's fine, but I don't understand why we have this training period for one board and not for our other boards.
Well, perhaps I misunderstand the comment you made. Just let me provide a statement to begin with and make sure we understand each other. First of all, the membership of the board, the associate membership on the board, is over and beyond an additional party or persons beyond the normal membership.
Well, it's 5 and 2,
right,
opposed to the 7 that the school board or the
are. So that if the concern was raised, in fact, it came to us after the original charter was given to the committee, and it, I believe, was raised in part because of a concern expressed by the person who was then filling the associate planning member role and who had resigned in frustration. Because of that, the committee talked about it at some length with the feeling that we were being asked really to endorse elimination of that role, which has been in place for a number of years, apparently. And the conclusion arrived at was that the associate member role does have a useful part to play, in part because the complexity of the regulations and rules that the board is asked to deal with is such that having a training wheel period is helpful, and also that person, as you mentioned, can fill in the absence of somebody else. The frustration came up because the tendency has been for board members to stay in their seats for a number of years, and so an associate member could be an associate member for a heck of a long time. And the hope was that the new term limit arrangement, which was adopted in the ordinance earlier, and which is suggested for a slight modification in this report, would help the turnover and thereby open up more opportunities for associate members. And the recommendation also is that associate members be clearly the first in line for an empty seat, which hasn't always been the case apparently in the past. As to why there should be associate members here and not at the school board or some other level, which of course are elected bodies, as opposed to these appointed bodies, I can't answer that. Didn't come up as a discussed item, except for the complexity and the concern on the part of a number of members that it really does take a long time to feel comfortable with the variety of regulations and the complexity of legal opinions and so on that you have to deal with. And in that context, the associate membership is a helpful starting point for some people.
If you, in fact, had an associate member who for a year was an associate member and that's all he was, I think you'd be correct. But that isn't what happens. What happens is the associates are asked to vote on a regular basis, but not all the time, just some of the time. And that inconsistency doesn't make sense to me. It seems like they either should vote or not vote. So the training wheel period isn't really in effect. They could be asked to vote on their very first night because somebody else has a conflict of interest. So that's the part I don't understand.
Okay. Well, I understand your concern. I personally have not participated as a member of the board either or an associate member, so I can't do anything other than report the discussion of the committee. And certainly, I assume by the time the Zork group gets done with the analysis of this and the attempt to sort of clean up the ordinance, that these issues will be discussed again, and another opportunity can be raised to evaluate that concern.
Thank you.
Councilor Nell.
Yeah. Mr. Warren, does one part of this associate member arrangement, does it make it easier to have a quorum to vote? In other words, because of conflicts of interest, is that part of the rationale behind
it? That's my understanding. That is a contributory factor to some people feeling that it's helpful to have.
Okay.
Yeah.
Councilor McGough.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hank, I don't want to be pugnacious tonight, but I do agree with Councilor Marvin's point about the associate members, and it seems to me if you have a proposal also to increase the number of terms whereby a full member is serving for 9 years, you could stay an associate member for what would seem eternity rather than shortening that period.
As I understand it, the original term arrangement was 2 5-year terms maximum.
Mm-hmm.
And more recent change dropped it to 3 years, 2 3-year terms,
right,
basically. And this recommendation was that because of the length of time that it takes someone to really get comfortable, that there should at least be the option for a third 3-year term, bringing it back up closer to what the original cap, if you will, was. Originally 10 years, 9 under this recommendation. However, I think it also needs to be kept in mind that there's no assurance or no charter that goes with appointment to either any of these boards. The council can and should, through its appointments committee and its own decisions, be evaluating the quality and attendance and participation of each member. And I presume from the discussion at the committee meetings that the assumption was that doing this every 3 years rather than every 5 would probably mean fewer reappointments, or at least shorter total terms, and therefore open up the opportunity for an associate member to fill a seat of a person who perhaps for whatever reason was not meeting the needs of the committee, or the needs of the commission, or excuse me, the board. That's the concept here, that the council needs to increase its scrutiny, if you will, of the quality of participation, and not be shy about replacing people at the end of a 3-year term if, in fact, they're not meeting the standards you would be setting.
As chairman of the appointments committee, I take that under advisement. I think you make some very good points. Since we're not going to take this to workshop, apparently, I guess.
I think if we're going to keep on going through it, that we better have my opinion, we ought to have a workshop on it so we can move on as far as the meeting goes. Everybody got a lot of questions on it?
I think there are a lot of things that could be discussed, and the manager made a recommendation that we talk about some more discussion.
Yeah. Councilor Dalbert.
I'm not sure that we need a workshop on the entire thing. I do think the issue of associate members belongs as a responsibility of the council, and that the council should look for a recommendation out of the appointments committee. I don't know that we need a workshop on everything else that's in here.
Anybody else? Yes, Councilor McGough.
Now can I talk? Hank, you're talking, one of your items is about board member recognition and appreciation. And I see the recommendation for a combination reception training session. Were there any other ideas? This is something the council's been grappling with for a while, is how to recognize its volunteers. And we have so very many in this town. And I'm wondering if you folks came up with any other thoughts for appropriate recognition mechanisms.
Well, I'd be going from memory, and I don't remember a lot about it, but I think we talked about such simple things as having a picnic once a year and inviting everybody to participate and using it as a morale-building, family-building process with a pat on the back to people who had a lot of extra effort or extra success or whatever you might want to recognize, clearly up to you. But anything, I think, as I read the committee, that that makes people other than just the chairs, who get their own sort of pats on the back just by being in the fun role that you play, sometimes people just don't feel as though anybody cares or acknowledges the work they put into, both before meetings, during meetings, and after meetings. And anything almost that acknowledges that would be helpful. The second aspect of it, and the one you mentioned, is the training issue, and there are several recommendations that relate to the concern that whether it's through associate board membership or whatever it is, that there does need to be a greater effort to provide pre-appointment or at least pre-meeting training, and then regular training for these people, whether it involves the town manager, the town attorney, the council chair, or whatever, seems to be appropriate, because sometimes they feel sort of like they get left, you know, they get handed a task and left to go do their own thing, and they do it well, but sometimes there are some complicated issues that come up, and when you get into things like dormer suits, which is one of the more recent ones that seem to be talked about a lot, there are fine points of law that people ought to be brought up to date on a regular basis, and doesn't sometimes happen. So those two ideas, if they can be meshed together sometimes, so much the better. You know, you have a training picnic, I don't know, but anything of that kind would be helpful, I think.
Okay, thank you. I do have other questions, but I'll ask them with staff later. Thank you.
Councilor Nell.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to, if the town manager can remember, remember verbatim his recommendation as to where to go with this, because to me, there's a tremendous amount of information. This report represents a tremendous amount of work, and I would hate to see, after all that work, some of these recommendations for streamlining and to be lost. And I'd like to, just to make sure we follow through on it. So if you could.
What I'd suggest, I know one concern I had is the council, particularly at your last meeting, referred quite a few issues to workshops, and you have a backlog of information that needs to be done. What I was suggesting with this particular report is that staff take it and work with Councilor Cogswell and with Hank to really, for those things that there seems to be unanimity on, to one, get them started, and it's pretty obvious what those things are, and two, for those that you know, involve other changes and other folks, to bring them into the dialogue and to actually have specific things that you can react to and vote upon and agree upon, rather than just keep kicking stuff around. The whole spirit of let's get on with it and do it. So what I was specifically recommending is that you direct copies be provided to the Planning Board, Zoning Board, Conservation Commission, and the ZORC Committee and department heads, and to request a report by October 1 on implementation progress. The reason for that is October 1 seems like a long ways off, but it really isn't during the summer. But particularly after all these groups receive copies of the report, I would like to meet individually with them and, you know, invite Maureen and whoever else wants to attend, just to get their reaction, find out what their top priorities are, and you know, involve them as much in the process. I know they've been represented on the committee, but just as, you know, has come out with the council this evening, there are things that when you bring more people together, there's more ideas, and just try to get this thing moving and keeping it moving. And I, without sounding, you know, that the council slows things down at workshops, it tends to be with all the other activity going on. I just didn't want this delayed until your September workshop or whatever, because my fear is with everything else on your plate that could happen.
Yes.
I would move the manager's recommendation.
I'll second.
It moved and seconded. Anybody else any comment? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item 23, to consider receiving the report of the Thomas Jordan Trust Implementation Committee and take any necessary action. manager, you kicked that off?
Yes, this committee was very ably led by former council chairman Lester Jordan. Others serving on the committee were Phyllis Cogsill, Councilor Bill Anell, Ed McComb, Jerry Petroselli, David Pratt, and Jack Roberts. It was a fascinating group, brought together many different skills and interests. They met on a frequent basis over the last several months and have come out with 15 recommendations, all of which, if adopted by the council, would immediately have sort of the standing of law. And this is something that's going to be in place for a long, long time, not like ordinances that you change quite a bit. So what I'm trying to do is hedge, you know, why did he recommend a workshop on one and not on another? This one I am recommending you send to a workshop because it may take another month or two, but it's extremely crucial that when you set it up, you're only going to set it up once, that's going to be the most influential time for the trust, and that's my suggestion.
Are you getting a comment? Council McLaughlin?
I yield to Council Cogsill.
I was just going to make a motion. Did you want to comment?
Go right ahead.
I move that we set the report to workshop as soon as possible.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody getting a comment?
I think we should commend the people on the committee also while we're at it for the great job they did.
Council Anell.
I'd just like to add that I think it is important that the council, that we discuss it at a workshop, but I think you'll find that it'll go pretty smoothly. I anticipate that it's very well explained here in the manager's report, and I think it'll be something that we can move quickly on.
I agree. I think the committee done a tremendous job, and they went into a lot of detail to get this document put together, and like the manager says, it's something that's going to be around the Cape for quite some time. And no other comment? All those in favor of the workshop, raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a vote. 7-0. Item 24, to consider a report from the town manager and from the town council members serving on the school building committee and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Chairman Jordan. As has been indicated in your memo and has been published in the Portland newspapers, the bids have been opened for the school renovation, school improvement project. The low bidder was an outfit by the name of D.L. Poulin Incorporated, who had a base bid of $8,693,158. In addition, the way the bids were set up, there were a number of alternates, 13 altogether, that were separately priced as part of the project. The reason that was done was, one, to get a sense of what different things cost. Two was just in case the budget needed to be cut, to know what could be cut and how much could be saved. And three, there were a couple of things on the list that were probably within the category it would be nice to do, but absolutely necessary to do. So for that reason, the bid was set up with a number of alternates. Some of the alternates, unfortunately, are issues that need to be done or should be done for one reason or another. One of those is the construction of a parking lot, which is part of the site plan approval. Another is, in my opinion, although some could disagree, is the Allied Arts Wing of the school. It had been promised or told to all the citizens back when the vote occurred that all of the schools were going to be renovated, that we were going to do it right, that all the systems were going to be updated, the facades and all of that. And that included at the time the Allied Arts Wing. Because the building committee wanted to have an out just in case the bids came in high, they did list that as an alternate, even though it all along it had been included as part of the work. As it turns out, fairly obvious there's not enough money to do everything, and that's fine, and the building committee has said no to a lot throughout the process, and still going to have to say no, and still, even with, if the proposal I'm making tonight's approved, there are still things that people would like to have done that aren't going to be done. Whenever you get into a situation like this, there are lots of different things that one can do. One is to go back and to redo a lot of plans. That's very difficult to do when you don't have cost for everything in the specifics. And you also don't know if you're getting a true discount or might have to pay something else later. Another is to go out and get more money from one source or another source. And there are other alternatives as well. I have recommended the alternative, essentially, that we go out for more money simply not by asking the citizens to approve another bond issue, but instead to use some municipal surplus dollars. Why town municipal surplus dollars and not school municipal surplus dollars? Town funds tend to be more elastic than school. They get a set amount from the state. They know what they're going to get. They don't have the revenues that we have that sometimes do better than other times. That's why we need to have the surplus on the municipal side. The school has never had that surplus, and besides, when they do, it's forced to be used as a credit to the next year's budget. I realize that before I get into the specific recommendations, that it's a very sensitive area. The citizens voted. They voted $11.7 million, and it's felt that ought to be the amount of the project. You know, I didn't make this recommendation lightly. When I went through and, you know, listened to a lot of the citizens when I went on the school tours, the criticism I heard more frequently than why are we going to pay $11.7 million is how did we allow things to get so bad in the first place? Why weren't things taken care of? Why weren't things done right the first time? And, you know, that's the position that, you know, I see ourselves in at this point. You know, if we're going to do the project, it's my sense, you know, let's do it right as much as possible. Let's not create other problems as a result of doing the project. I've chosen, in looking at the list, three specific projects that were included as alternates that I think the council should give some consideration to. The reason I chose these three is because I think they all have somewhat of a community tie, other than just directly a school project. As well as the fact that I think that each is crucially important. The first is a parking lot that's to be built at the side of the high school driveway heading to the rear of the high school. This is to replace the student parking lot, which is now across from that area, which has now become the bus parking lot. It was necessary to tear down the bus parking garage. The building committee looked at a number of other areas in order to possibly put buses for reasons of security, space, and access to utilities. No other location was found that was feasible. Therefore, we need to create parking spaces to make up for that displacement. The other real advantage of this lot is that it also is very accessible to some of the different athletic fields. The earlier agenda item we discussed about people parking for, you know, on fields and other areas. This parking lot is you don't need to cross the road to get to most of the athletic field. It's all within the one green area. And it's also very handy to the community services wing and some of the other nighttime activities. It's parking real close to the schools as opposed to far away. The second specific recommendation is for a storage building. It also, again, relates to the buses. For what I refer to in my memorandum as bus stuff. These are all the odds and ends that you need to have alongside buses in order to maintain the buses and to support the drivers in the mission of transporting the kids to school. That includes places to store tires, all of the different cleaning equipment, you know, issues such as you drive the bus back to the shop at night, but there's no longer a shop. You drive the bus, you know, back into the lot at night, you know, kids are bound to leave a few odds and ends on buses. You know, where do you put them? Do you leave them in the bus? Do you, you know, the trash and that, or do you have a place to put them? This building, which is about the size of a two-car garage, would provide storage space for all that, and it would also be a base of operations for the school bus drivers. They would have a place to, I don't want to use the word hang out, as if bus drivers aren't busy, but I think, you know, anyone, wherever they work, you know, need a place that's a base of operations, other than, you know, the driver's seat in a vehicle. The third specific, and the other issue I should have is, should mention, I have a concern, is that I'm worried that if we don't do this, we're going to create a lot of pressure on the public works garage. We don't, when that was designed, we didn't expand the storage space in that building. We certainly didn't plan it based on the fact that we're going to have school buses being supported out of that facility. So that's an additional concern of mine, is that if the school, through the project and through these funds, doesn't provide for this need, then it's going to be on the bus, it's going to be on the public works garage. One other point I do want to make on this portion is, I don't think this would ever be funded by the building committee. I'm very open about that. You know, there are, when you look at all the different alternates and where they stand with the budget, taking care of bus storage needs probably wouldn't be at the top of the list. And I have a special spot in my heart, I have to admit, for, you know, some of the folks in the school system who aren't the teachers, you know, more for the custodians, the bus drivers, the aides, and some of those folks. And, you know, they need the facilities and the adequate support services as well. And I think this would be a statement in that regard, that, you know, even though we're missing the valuable resource of the bus garage, at least we still have a place where we're attending to the needs of the support that the buses themselves need. The third project is very much a community facility, although it is used by the school department, and that's what is now a basketball court. It was first donated by the Sprague Corporation as a tennis court, and it's over by the middle school field and sort of in back there. If you drive by there on any decent night, there's almost always young adults there, older adults, as well as young folks. I think I covered everyone. playing basketball on that court. And I, although I'm not a big basketball player myself, never did have the height, I do think that, you know, that is a resource, particularly as we look at, you know, the drug issues and some of the others, you know, kids, the issue of the teen center that comes up from time to time. This is one facility that's out there. It's one of the few things that isn't regularly scheduled, you know, that kids can still have pickup games and adults and, you know, really enjoy that. And unfortunately, the project did not include replacement dollars for that basketball court. And I think, you know, it's one of those issues that if you didn't provide for it now, my sense is there'd be a lot of pressure to replace that in kind as the years go on. Altogether, these add up to $117,000. I had trouble with numbers, as others did at the building committee meeting, and somehow it's more with my own writing. I carried a 64, is a 62, but it's actually a 64. So it's $64,000 for the parking lot, $24,000 for the equipment storage building for the buses, and $29,000 for the basketball court. And I realize this is difficult, and it's no one likes to ask for more money, but I do it confident that I think it is the best approach for the town long range, and would recommend that you allocate those funds out of the municipal surplus.
Thank you. Now, with the chairman of the school board sitting out there, and Chapman, would you like to add anything to this?
I didn't really come tonight intending to speak, but just to hear what you had to say and answer any questions that you might have. I would like to thank Michael for his excellent memo and his synopsis of his memo. I think he is correct in stating that perhaps some of these priorities would not be the top priorities, at least of some of the school board members on the committee, because we are, you know, above all interested in fixing the buildings and making them an appropriate space for the kids and the teachers. I don't think I've made any secret of my great disappointment that at this point the Allied Arts Wing is not in the project. If you do see fit to fund at least the the parking lot, which was required of us in our site plan approval. It would go a long way towards us being able to find the money to include that in the project, which I do think is an important thing that we promised the community. I think one of the frustrating things to me in this whole process, and I didn't, you asked me to speak, so I'm just going to say it, is how much time and attention and money we are willing to pour into the site and the parking on this project. And the time even that was spent tonight talking about the parking around the buildings, that sometimes the buildings seem a little bit peripheral to people. And I just want to point out that I think once this project is complete, I don't think people will feel very proud if we have the most gorgeous parking lot and trees of any school site in Maine, but our buildings are still not up to par. So anything you could do to help us in that regard, we would surely appreciate.
Thank you. Anybody got any comments? Yes, Councilor Dahlbeck.
I think we need a motion first.
Yes. All right.
Can I speak, Council?
Yes.
My name is Henry Adams. I have talked with the town manager twice concerning this item, and I'm deeply concerned with the underlying principle that's involved here. The voters narrowly passed a school bond issue, 52% to 48% against. After the bond issue, the town manager told me that this was a very divisive issue and the school project would never get one more cent beyond the 11.7 approved by the voters. Now what's taking place? He's suggesting that the 48% against be ignored, and he wants to shift townside municipal money toward the project because there are not enough for all of the wants of the school department. The building committee included these items under discussion in the bid document. Now there's not enough money. The town manager wants to circumvent the entire process. If there's not enough money to do the project, you've got to go back to the drawing board. And don't blame the planning board for their demands. It's the building committee and the school department that must reconcile the differences, and not Mr. McGovern and the municipal side tax dollar. This is a prime example of the saying, don't let the camel get his nose in the tent. You recall Mr. Ganley in Portland when they wanted to finish Hadlock Field. And lo and behold, he found $500,000 in none other than in the public works budget. There may be some undesignated surplus in the municipal side, but the camel's nose belongs to the school department if they want to get the project finished. The ball is not in Mr. McGovern's court, and he freely admitted to me that this suggestion was subterfuge to get the projects approved. And I looked up subterfuge in the dictionary, and it means a ruse or a trick. Now, I'm definitely not alone in this matter. There are several others who feel as I do. And all, if they were here tonight, would say the very same thing, but I told them that I would express our serious concerns this evening. I think this is a very unfortunate, unorthodox approach by the manager and does nothing more than breed the seeds of distrust in town government. And I urge that you not do any action on this tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. Do I hear a motion?
I would move approval of the recommendation made by the town manager.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody got any comment?
I do.
Yes. Councilor Dahlbeck.
I served on the school building committee. And I must say that I was somewhat disappointed to find the bids weren't as low as I hoped they would be, and there were some things that we might have to leave out. My own attitude was a little bit of so be it on the one hand. On the other hand, I know a lot is being spent on site work on this whole project that had not been anticipated at all. but was being done because we unfortunately aren't in the position of finding a new site. We are trying very hard to work with what we have, and what we have is not great, and it's not very large, and so there we are. I think we ought to make sure we look at this as a town issue. As far as I'm concerned, we can play the we-they between town and school, but I'd prefer the one-town concept as a much better concept, and I think this is a town issue. I know, for example, that the school building committee and the school committee looked at this additional parking site and, in effect, said, we have ways not to have an additional parking site. We are underutilizing some of the parking we have now. We can ration the parking to students, for example. We don't need to have open parking, and I think a few of us who have listened to a lot of this said, wouldn't it be nice if more students used the bus instead of their Mercedes to get to school? But it could be rationed more. The planning board was not conducive to that idea, and I'm not about to critique what the planning board said, what have you, but it was not the school building committee nor the school's idea that we couldn't maybe cut there, but when the planning board was done, that was not appropriate. I'm not against utilizing some town funds as long as we have available town funds and as long as there is not an impact on the taxes. I am also not shook at the fact that part of the school wouldn't be completed, except that there'll probably be down the road a few thoughts expressed about school board, the town council, the school building committee, and what have you, for not having completed what we set out to do. But as long as there is some money available, I would like to say that I will support the town manager's recommendation.
Anyone else?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
If I supported this in any way, I would want several things, I think, answered before I could vote yes. The school board and the building committee, I think, should be doggone mad at the architect that these things were not brought up and in the original 11.7. Because when that bond thing was voted on by the people, they would have voted you the 11.9 as well as the 11.7, and we wouldn't be in this mess that we're in right now. Because I don't like additions after you've had a bond issue. And we were told that 11.7 would do the job. Now, my point is this, that I want answered by somebody before I get too far into this. How much more is it going to cost than the other $3 million that we've got for administration and professional fund? Is that going up another $100,000 too because we can't do it, that $3 million is not the figure? You see, my doubt is that if you can't hit the right figure on the 8.7, are you sure you hit the right figure on the $3 million? There's several little things there that I can't answer to people that I talk to. What's the final thing going to be when all the bills are paid, never mind the shifting between the school and the municipal? Because I'm on Dick's side there 100%. This is a town center project. Belongs to all of us, and we want to do it right. But I'm not sure we're doing it right if we're not given figures that people can work with. I think you've done an awful good selling job. I think you've made me feel like I'm in the minority sitting over here, in that I'm saying no now, but 11.7, I think that it should be done for that, or we ought to find out and get some cuts off the architect's fee or somewhere to pay for the $115,000, because somebody, I'm not saying who, but somebody goofed. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
I'd like to just partially maybe respond to that.
Okay, go ahead, Councilor Dolman.
Yes, when we discussed this in the school building committee, there was a strong sentiment by some of the members on the committee, not including the two councilors present, to utilize some of the funds that had been budgeted for such things as furniture or some of the other reserves. I'm not too sure, I can't remember all of the specifics, But in effect, let's get the money out of some things and maybe hope that the furnishings budget's a little high or this is a little high. And we resisted that. We did not want to clip into that. And some of that's a guesstimate, but some of that's also flexible. You can always cut back on furniture and what have you. But we resisted going into what had been set aside for that amount so that we would have enough to play with. I think that's a fairly honest statement, and I'm looking at Ann if she wants to shake her head one way or the other.
I think what you said is that. Councilor
Cogshaw. I had a few questions I wanted to ask, first of all, of Mr. McGovern. You partially answered my question as far as that parking lot being part of the plan that's been approved by the DEP. Have we received their approval yet?
Yes, we have.
And that takes into account our study of the stormwater drainage. How is that going to be impacted?
Yeah. What the school project has assumed a number of costs for piping, for a stormwater detention basin, and other areas that take into account the town center plan and the need to retain the water on site. The DEP approval also indicates that we need to stabilize the ditch that runs alongside the high school driveway extending from where this new parking lot would go down to the outfall. That is not funded, that long stabilization of that ditch, and is part of the town center plan and does need to be done. It is part
right.
of the
that was one of the recommendations
it is
of
part
the engineer
of the condition of approval,
and we were going to do that as part of our project. And what about the ADA ramp access for the tennis courts? That was also somewhere in that vicinity.
That is not funded as a result of this project, nor in the ADA bond currently.
But it's still going to be able to be done the way it was drawn?
Oh, yes. It is part of the site plan approval.
It is.
But it's referenced there that it can be done, but it's not a required.
So the engineering and all the details are still intact?
Exactly.
Okay.
It was shown on the plan, so we wouldn't have to go for another approval for it.
Okay. Also, this field that's going to be converted to a student parking lot, is that a playing field of any sort?
It's used as a practice field for warm-up, particularly for warm-ups, I think, during field hockey season. And
okay. Community services.
Community services for odds and ends. Yep.
And the student parking lot is going to be completely taken over by the buses?
You don't want buses backing up and moving around where private vehicles are in the
So that entire that lot's going to be lost?
Yeah.
And where on that lot is this bus garage going to be placed?
The bus storage building?
Yes.
It's when they went through the zoning board for approval, it was moved to the back corner of the lot, hidden behind the IGA loading dock.
Oh, that's I'm glad to hear that, because that is kind of a nice vista we have looking down through there. I guess I have to go on to make my other comments. I guess the scenic vista studies and the stormwater drainage study was considered, I understand. This was an extremely large project, one of the biggest we've ever undertaken in this town, but perhaps it had a totally unrealistic time frame. The engineering estimates were short-sighted for an experienced firm. The estimates for the site work in particular, and as far as the existing ordinances that we have already in place as to number of parking lots that are required for a project like this, and all of you have said that number was never considered as part of their estimate. And I'm very upset that the facilities that previously were existing and removed by this project, and that their replacement was not part of the overall project. I think that we're playing money games, that we have a memo referencing the fact that SMRT wants to renegotiate their contract because of overtime and unexpected architectural and engineering expenses and unforeseen problems. So I have a feeling this is just the beginning, or the camel in the tent, as Mr. Adams wanted to reference. But I think this is a town project, but I think that we're suffering from too tight a timeframe, and that perhaps things weren't fully analyzed before we got into dollars.
Thank you. Councilor Nell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I tend to agree with Councilor Chappell's comments. He's reluctant to see this go on and on. I do recognize, I'd really hate to see that Allied Arts building taken out, I really would. The other things that the town manager mentioned I think are important. I think it's important for the folks that drive those buses have a place to hang their hat. I'm mindful, though, that the voters voted for 11.7, and one point I may not agree with Councilor Chappell, though, is I'm not sure. It's an assumption, I think, that they might have also voted for 11.9. They may well have voted it down if it was 11.9. That's something we don't know. There's a couple of questions that I'd like answered. I don't expect it to happen tonight, but I know that we've charged the school board with coming up with a five-year maintenance plan, because we've talked about how we got into this mess in the first place. And before I vote for more money out of the town budget, I'd like to see some sort of five-year plan that's been talked about for quite a while for the maintenance of the buildings. I'd like to know what the average increase in salary is for school teachers and so forth who got a substantial raise this year. And I'm certainly not against education. I mean, I voted for the school project and spoke in favor of it. And I know that teachers are generally underpaid and overworked. However, I'm not sure that this is the year for, while other, if we're talking about this one town concept, I'm not sure that this is the year when other town employees took a cut in benefits for teachers to be getting an increase in benefits. I'm a little concerned that when push came to shove a few months ago in the school budget, that they solved part of the budget crunch by letting a janitor go. And one thing we've been so critical or concerned about is how we got into this mess in the first place. And now maybe that was the best thing to do. I mean, I'm just saying that I'm a little bit concerned that that they very recently part of their budget balancing plan was to cut back on maintenance. So I guess if we're referring to this camel image of letting the camel in the tent, I would like to see the school department feed the camel for a while. I think these things are all important, but I think it's important that somewhere we have to draw the line, and I'd like to see some contributions from the school department before I would vote in favor of it. Thank you.
Anyone else? Council Marv.
I think in looking at this, we need to ask ourselves, what was the intent of the voters in Cape Elizabeth? And I think the intent was that we build a new school. And I agree with Councilor Chappell that if it had been 11.7 or if it had been 11.9, I don't think that was the issue. I think what they told us is that they need a new school. I think we could spend a lot of time talking about whose fault all this is, but I'm not sure that that really helps us. I think what we need to do is resolve this issue. If there's somebody who gets shortchanged in the circle of life here in Cape Elizabeth, it's probably the bus drivers. And if there's somebody who I want to feel good about themselves and their job, it's the bus drivers, because my children get on a bus every day. So I think that were penny wise and pound foolish to look at cutting out something like a bus garage or a parking lot. I think really what we need to do is figure out how we can pay for the things that we need. And the question that I have is, I assume there's a contingency fund for this project. How much money is in it? What is that money supposed to be for? And is it possible to maybe shift some of those funds to pay for some of these issues?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, the contingency fund is approximately $830,000. It was 10% of the engineer's original estimate for the construction portion of the project. When the building committee discussed this issue, and whether or not, and the school board as well, whether or not to dip into the contingency, it was heavily debated on whether or not that was appropriate. And I think for a lot of the reasons Councilor Cogswell stated earlier, of how quickly the time frame was done in this project, and the pressure that the architects were under to get it going so that it could be reach this window of this construction season while school is open, everyone is extremely nervous about whether or not everything was uncovered in time, and whether or not there may be things that we don't know about. So it was strongly recommended that we keep the contingency. Part of the scheduling, for example, Portland voted for a middle school project a year ago in June, and that's still not out to bid, and you could name project after project. This one was very much hurried. The architects were really challenged, the school personnel were really challenged, even the boards, the DEP and the Bureau of General Services, all of whom have come under criticism, I think all went through each of these in near record time, through the reviews in near record time for the complexity of this project. So anyway, I'm getting off the point, but the point is, because of the complexity of the project and the speed in which it was prepared, it was felt that this was not the time to touch the contingency at this early point and instead leave it open for change orders for true things that are found during construction rather than wants and needs that are identified at this point in time.
Now, did the architect understand what our time frame was before they accepted the job?
Yes, they did.
Yes, they did.
Yes.
Yeah, the issue that Councilor Cogswell raised that was in the minutes was referred to a subcommittee of the building committee to report back to the building committee at a later date. The subcommittee is the group that consists of the members of the building committee that negotiated the original contract with the architects. And no one commented at the building committee on the merits of the request. I think there was some discussion and agreement that, yes, this was a challenging project, but there was no commitments were given or no indications were given as to how that might be reacted to.
Councilor Cogswell.
I just wanted to ask also a couple of questions about this bus equipment storage building that you refer to as being a place for bus drivers to hang out. That means it's going to be heated and have bathrooms and all these other facilities?
That's probably poor terminology. The superintendent of schools is here, and maybe she could comment better on how
I'm
she
just
sees
wondering
that
if
facility
it,
being utilized.
That was.
It's not going to have bathrooms.
It's not going to have bathrooms, okay. Michael just made it sound like it was a special rest area room for the bus drivers, and I wanted to find out exactly how detailed this construction is.
Yes, Superintendent.
Well, the number of issues have been brought up tonight, and
you want to touch on them all?
I don't think I can. I think this is perhaps, you will indulge me perhaps with a moment of reflection on the scope of this project. The money is substantial for the town. There's been no question this is a large project with lots of complexities and really impossible to go back over the many hours that the building committee has actually spent in looking at all this complexity. Four of us are here. Two of your counselors, the town manager, myself, and two school board members are here who have spent, I don't know that we could estimate the number of hours, not only listening to these issues in committee meeting, but also in many subcommittee and also other kinds of individual attention. I think that it is fair to say that when we look around at comparable school projects, this one has always been a bargain. Our neighboring community of Scarborough, which has a new middle school, originally, in the paper at least, talked as about as a school for 600 pupils. Now, I did see something recently talking about size for 800, is a $10 million project. We are talking about making not only two buildings for at least 1,200 students habitable, up to speed, able to do things in computer and science education that we are not able to do now, some very basic necessities. But we've also discovered in going through this project that the whole campus has not been looked at since 1970, probably since 1965, when the current high school was being looked at. That means we have inherited all kinds of campus problems, and it is that inheritance that has brought us to this issue tonight. To be perfectly honest, as a school person standing here, we know that the 11.7 is what the architects gave us. They are very, frankly, I've been impressed with their skill. I have worked with a number of different firms in the area that I also have respect for, but these are not people who have in any sense slighted their duties or cut corners in spite of the fact that they knew they inherited a rather pressing schedule. I would like to point out to the town council and to the town, that one of the pressures on the schedule was trying to borrow money before interest rates went up. They are already going up, and we do not know how much faster or how much more they will go up. So one of the very real pressures on this project has been to try to get it out to bid within a time frame that would take advantage of the lowest interest rates for a generation. So that those are the kinds of things, and I missed a little bit of this discussion as I came down this evening, but I think it would be unfair, in a word, unfair to a very reputable firm if we did not give them full credit for doing, accepting a difficult challenge, but doing a good job with it. I think that in inheriting the problems of the entire campus, as well as the, I think, good planning that's gone into the town center concept, that the architects did, in fact, have to deal with problems that they had not been informed about when we originally interviewed them for this project. That was not our fault as a school department or the fault of the school building committee. It was simply the way in which these things go. Sometimes planning is going on concurrent with other things. Therefore, they did inherit problems such as having to put in larger drain pipes and et cetera, catch basins, et cetera, that there was absolutely no way that they could know about when we, in fact, took the project on. Those issues have impacted the $14.7 million. Another point I'd like to make is the fact that as far as the school department is concerned, if we do not get that extra parking lot, frankly, I'm prepared to go to the high school community and have lotteries on parking spots as far as students is concerned. This is not a pressure that is coming to you from the school department. This is Michael has appropriately tagged this as a community issue. It's not a school issue. Frankly, I'd just as soon have the high school students take the bus. We provide bus service. It's an additional problem for us to have cars there during the day, but we do know that there is heavy use on the facilities during the night for community services, for community use, and that it is, in fact, a community parking lot. As far as the bus garage is concerned, I have found in the files memos talking about the former use of the bus garage as a teaching station. I think that was post-World War II. In the late 40s, early 50s, and I even found a memo that was part of some kind of planning process that was going on in the 80s as to whether or not it was appropriate to rejuvenate that building, and it was clearly evident it could not be used as a teaching station. It was such kind of sort of grasping at straws that delayed the kind of planning that's been going on not just this past year or past 2 years, but since October of 1990, and I might remind you that that was a crisis that was triggered by a planning process that was not supported by sufficient funds to do it properly, and so we are in fact doing this properly. If you cannot see fit to deal with requests that Michael has brought to you, and the school department certainly applauds and appreciates his efforts to help us through a multifaceted community campus issue, then so be it. It is certainly possible for us to work with the architects and with the building committee, as we have done in the past with full, I think it's been the best committee, the best one-town concept effort that I have seen ever. It's just impressive. We are quite prepared to go further into working through our problems. But I think that it was a legitimate request to bring to your attention that the figure that was set by the architects was a conservative figure. They were not aware of the campus issues that they have inherited, we have inherited. We have done our best to solve as many of those problems as we can, in addition to the problems that are directly educationally oriented. We understand your pressures. We appreciate your consideration of this. And you have to do what you have to do. I do would like, to, however, to comment on the maintenance issue. The dropping of a custodian was considered a one-year issue because two-thirds of our plant will not be under the same kind of care that we normally have. We have people spread around in a variety of reasons. We have a variety of internal issues. It is not that we intend to do a less acceptable job. It was seen very clearly as a temporary shifting of resources, and we have made some other allocations. We have a very credible beginning of a five-year plan. We did, in fact, have to cut back some on what we had planned to do as far as addressing the high school, but we have a great deal of work scheduled there. I will welcome a forum to discuss that in the future in far more detail, but I would just like to comment on that. If you have any other specific question, and since I heard a number of associated issues, I'm not sure if I've been clear in answering them. The bus garage itself, by the way, I should say the process by which we have dealt with that. We first elicited a request for proposals to see if there was any way we could move the garage. That was a possibility that was raised at one point. Nobody could give any hope at all. In fact, we were told, frankly, it absolutely could not be done. We then went out to bid for the material and the building itself. We had a number of people come through. They walked through. They asked questions. And ultimately, we only had one person who happens to be an employee of the school department who bid on it. And he has spent some of his own money and his time and so forth to simply deal with the issue. It had to be removed because, the campus site issues are so crowded. We could not improve our parking situation without removing it. And we have thoroughly studied it. It cannot be moved, and it was not remediable as it stood. And as far as the bus garage facility, it's like a two-car garage. It is mainly storage. It probably would have some warm weather capacity for people to sit down and have a cup of coffee. We would, in fact, have electricity, but no internal plumbing. There is a plan to have external water so the buses can be hosed off, but that would be it. Are there any other questions? I'm sure I left lots of things out, but I'd be happy to answer them if I could. Yes.
Connie, what on the five-year maintenance plan, do you have any idea when that could, when we would receive that? When is that? Would that
yes, completed? We have a sketchy outline of that. And the thing that holds us back on that is when you're talking about a five-year maintenance plan, you're basically talking about the high school as far as projects, perhaps some ADA issues. But clearly, we see the project as taking care of baseline renovation for the other two buildings. We certainly know what has to be done, and we have sketched that out. But we don't have all the details.
Thank you. I am curious about, where the salaries have gone.
Oh, yes.
Can you tell us can you provide?
Oh, absolutely. That's all public information, and we're very glad to share it. I myself have not had a raise since I came to work here, nor do I intend to ask for one, for what that's worth. As far as the rest of our employees are concerned, we have negotiated long and hard, and they fall between 3% and 4%, including benefits. The only exception to that is that there are some employees who are on steps, and steps add a piece on top of that. Now, the teacher's situation falls within that guideline also, but you must, I think, recognize that we are transitioning out of career ladder, and that makes it very difficult for us to tell you that every employee got a certain amount of money. But that has been the guideline. I notice that Charlie is here. Both he and Ann have negotiated with units this year, as have I, and although I don't happen to have the figures with me, I can assure you it is between 3% and 4%.
Thank you.
Okay, you all done with that? Because I don't think that's part of the issue that we're discussing. If you want to do it at a later date, we could. Okay?
Thank you. That's fine.
Anybody else got any comment as far as the motion? Yes, manager.
Yeah, I just wanted to very briefly respond to my very good friend, and I mean that, Henry Adams. Henry made a reference, you know, that there was some sort of subterfuge here. And I'd like to address that directly because, you know, I think I've been very open that there is one. And that's that if you look at the way this is established, it's being asked to fund the community parking lot and other things. And as has been explained, the community parking lot, by funding that, it does free up money for the Allied Arts Wing or whatever else the school building committee wants. And you know, that is a subterfuge, and by asking and funding one thing, it does free up money for something else. And I think that, you know, is very open and direct, and that is what the subterfuge is here. And I feel very good that, you know, even though it is a subterfuge, that there's no attempt to keep it quiet or to not have everyone fully understand you know, what is going on, that the whole issue with the community parking lot and, you know, emphasizing that it's a community use as well as a school use is, you know, meant in part to, you know, encourage and recognize that it is a community use as well as a school use, and that if the town council does fund it, it does free up money for the Allied Arts Wing. So I just wanted to respond to my good friend Henry and wish to thank him for his direct comments as well.
Councilor McGough.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. There was one comment in the memorandum we had on this that the cost for the tennis, for the basketball court, may have been included in the base bid. Do we know if it was or not at this point?
Frankly, I know Michael and I had a conversation on that on Friday, and I have not been able to track that down. Obviously, should that be the case, that is good news. I do not know that at this point.
Okay.
I similarly tried to track it down, and the architect didn't get back to me.
All right. I think from the discussion this evening, we all are aware of how difficult a decision this is. The one thing I would offer is perhaps a thesaurus or a dictionary, because I'm not sure subterfuge is the right word being used by anybody, and I'm uncomfortable with that. The basketball court, yes, is used by the community. It's not just used by children who are in school right now. It's used by other people who either have gone through our school system or who have moved here later in their lives or just like to play basketball, no matter what their height is. I do agree that that is a valid community issue. The equipment storage building, I think, has been spoken to very well this evening. We're not having a garage. I wish people would stop calling it a bus garage, too. It's a storage building, and I did have some confusion on that. In the parking lot, we're displacing an existing parking lot. I understand we will have even fewer spaces in the proposed parking lot. The location of that proposed parking lot does make sense. I know there are other ways to deal with it. The approval, however, includes that, and rather than going back through the process, it's something that apparently has been agreed upon that we need through that approval process. I agree with Councillor Marvin. Let's now find the ways to pay for what we really need. When I was campaigning this spring, one issue I did hear about was the issue of taxes. And I think one important thing that perhaps has not been stressed enough in this discussion so far tonight is that there is not an impact on the tax rate to do what is being proposed. I think that's very, very important. That's what a lot of people were voting for or against. That influenced a lot of people's votes last fall. A lot of people felt if they voted for the school project, they were voting for an increase in their tax rate. Some people voted for it thinking that, even thinking that, some people could still vote for it because they knew the importance of the project, what it meant to the entire town, not just to the children and the staff within that school building. I think this project really is a very good reflection of our one-town concept. Councilor Dahlbeck has referenced that, and as have others who have spoken this evening. I think the manager is helping us, helping the community find ways to pay for what we need to do. I'm going to support the proposal. Thank you.
Anybody else? I just want to want to say that I support the project, but as far as the baseball court and the building for the equipment storage building and the buses, I would like to have this council and even the school board members take a hard look of what's around the complex or around the community, that we could put the buses somewhere else and find a place somewhere else for the buses. I can't see taking a parking lot that is needed very badly, in my opinion, and use it to store buses, and then turn around and build another one. I think that the other one really should be built also. There isn't parking spaces enough around when you have any good function going on within the complex. And I think we should put our heads together and see if we couldn't come up with some place, somewheres, that would be an area to store the buses. And as far as the basketball court, I go either way on that. And I think it's something that belonged to the project, but I still believe that it's a community use, and that is a way for it to be funded. People, I know it's not going to affect the tax rate this year, but if you spend $115,000 this year, to me it affects the tax rate another year. You would have it there. And I'm not sure if we follow this through as far as the ledge work and the preparing the site and what have you. They have covered themselves pretty well because there's a lot of unknown ledge there. And let's hoping that there would be something left there. And also, the contingency, if we stay on top of, well, maybe there would be something there that we could finish that. We build a shell for the Allied Arts area, but too bad we can't do something to finish the inside of it for the use. And also, this project, I want people to understand, had a lot of drainage and stormwater added to this project to cover the community center project, and I feel that some of that has added to the cost of doing it, which should be done, and there's a lot of drainage that's got to be done. So I think there's a cost there that is community-wide that's added to the project that could have been separated out if you wanted to do it, but it was a time-consuming job for the architects to do it. And so I'm not one to go over the price of the project, but I am one that's going to support the $115,000. Thank you. Anybody else?
I'd move the question.
Everybody ready for the question? All those in favor, raise your right hand. One, two, three. Those opposed? One, two, three, four. Question does not prevail. Back to the drawing boards. Item 25. to consider clarification on the maturity dates, the school ADA, and the Thomas Jordan bond issue, and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. What this does is brings in the maturity dates of the bonds into compliance with the dates that we actually plan to pay them back around the tax due date. It extends the maturity dates for each of the bonds previously authorized by 45 days.
Any questions? Do I hear a motion?
Yeah, I move.
You move.
Second.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor, raise your right hand. Those opposed? It's a vote. Item 26, to consider a report from the Chief of Police and the Public Works Director regarding signage on Bowery Beach Road and on Ocean House Road near the current Greenbelt terminus, and take any necessary action. What's your wishes? Go ahead.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. What the Chief and the Director of Public Works have recommended is that we install six signs along Bowery Beach Road along the driveways at number 7, 9, and 11 on either side of the, with each, a sign on either side of each driveway that reads no parking between signs. There's currently an existing ordinance within the traffic schedule that prohibits parking within so many feet of a driveway. This merely would sign that in order to improve the sight distance coming out of these driveways. Should folks otherwise try to park in these areas to access the green belt approaching Great Pond. And the residents of the area are here this evening.
Thank you. Do I hear a motion? Councilor Nell.
Mr. Chairman, I propose a motion to approve a no parking policy in the area of Bowery Beach Road near the Greenbelt walking path, which would be marked by a total of six signs, with two signs placed on either side of the driveways, number 7, 9, and 11 Bowery Beach Road.
Do I hear a second? Any other questions, comment? No? All those in favor? Raise your right hand. Those opposed? 7-0.
Well enough alone, right?
Yeah. To consider a report from the Ordinance Committee regarding amendments to the zoning ordinance related to accessory dwelling units and take any necessary action. Council Cogshaw.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before you tonight, you have the draft that has been worked on for a number of months by the committee. There are a couple of issues we couldn't quite resolve, so we decided to forward them to you, to the town attorney, and ultimately this needs to be referred to the planning board for their input as well. There are two major policy changes. One is the reduction of the size of the house from 20 that can have an accessory dwelling unit added from 25,000 square feet to 1,500 square feet. This accessory apartment size also has been reduced from 900 square feet to 300 to 600 square feet. We felt that this would make more people eligible just because they weren't able to afford a large home but needed to have living space for an elderly family member. This would allow them to apply and be able to have that facility available. Another policy change is that originally it was allowed in existing single-family dwelling units, provided and not including any additions that have been made within the past 5 years. Now this will allow it to be constructed in new dwelling units. There is one particular section of the ordinance under 1947, subsection D, subsection 1, where we continue the old language of not allowing a dwelling unit, accessory dwelling unit, to be approved in an addition that had been made within the past 5 years. That was the particular issue we couldn't quite resolve in committee. The letter from our town attorney says that we're treating two situations differently, which might give an applicant an argument that the ordinance violates the Equal Protection Clause of the Maine and United States Constitutions. I feel that if we're going to allow it in a new house, that if an existing house can meet all the criteria, including their addition, it should be allowed. Another section, Section 8, where we deal with home occupations or not allowing an accessory unit to be added to a house that has that approval. We also had discussed that no variance would be allowed for the addition in order to be able to meet these requirements. That was not included. And I recommend that be forwarded as a consideration also to the Planning Board. Any questions?
Do I hear a second?
Therefore, I move that we pass this on to the Planning Board and ask that they possibly have a report by November 1st. Is that unrealistic, Michael? At least their comments.
That's realistic because they don't deal with accessory structures that much. It's mainly the zoning board.
It's mostly the zoning board. And we did have sitting on all our at all our meetings, Larry Clough, who was the former chairman of the Zoning Board of Appeals and who had been on the zoning board for about 7 years. So we had their prospective representative represented very, very well, as well as drafting language.
Do we hear a second?
Second.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I do have a couple of questions on this proposed language. In paragraph number one, the accessory dwelling unit may be created with an existing floor area 1,500 square feet or more prior to the addition of an accessory dwelling unit. My concern is with the word addition. My understanding of the language is that the accessory dwelling unit could be created within the existing footprint, or it could be created within a physical addition to the building. I think using the word addition there seems to indicate that it could only be done by a physical addition, and I think whoever looks at this before it comes back to us for a public hearing, I would like to see probably either the word creation, or I'd like to see that worded so it's clearly understood that it could be either within the footprint or a physical addition to the building. I do share Councilor Cogswell's concern about having different rules for a newly constructed home or a home which has had a physical addition within 5 years. I do not like, if we say it's okay for a new home to have one of these accessory units, then I don't care if your addition was in the past 6 months. I think you too should be allowed to have the accessory.